Today's walk starts down here in Homerton, on the marshy edge of Hackney. Originally it was known as Humberton, is recorded in the 14th century. I think its name comes from the farm of a woman called Humber. I'll write that on the screen here, Humber. And here we're on coming out to Homerton High Street. I think this was once known as Humberton Street. And by the 1600s, this is where you kind of had like wealthy city merchants would come and live around here. You had some kind of grand houses. There's actually some nice old terraces down there, actually. But the destination of today's walk is to come down here from the marshy levels down in Humberton, go through Hackney, through Dalston, through Newington Green, and hopefully finish our walk up in the legendary land of Highbury, on Highbury Fields, one of my favourite places in the whole of London. I genuinely mean that. Look at this lovely old stone building. This was probably 1930s, I would say. St Barnabas Hall School, it says up there somewhere. This looks like it might be one of the older houses of Homerton, one of the grand old mansions. So Homerton is said to lie just to the north of the Hackney Brook. And seeing the way these little streets drop down the hill there, the feeling the Hackney Brook might be somewhere there at the bottom, makes its confluence with the River Lee down at Old Ford. I think this estate here is either being massively regenerated or perhaps even demolished. I lived in Hackney in the early 90s, and in some ways Hackney's changed an awful lot. You know, it's synonymous now with like Hackney hipsters and stuff. And you can see around here, it's very youthful. It's been gentrified a bit. It's kind of associated with artisan coffee and craft beer and all of that stuff, sourdough bread, etc. But there's a part of Hackney that hasn't changed that much either, actually. I do remember going to visit friends in that estate. And back then in the early 90s, you could get council flats, I wouldn't say easily, but they used to do these lotteries for hard to let flats. And you turn up at the estate hall on a certain night, put your name in at the door, and then they would just literally draw tenancies out of the box. But they were always for places that, say, where they were having trouble to house people there. Over the road here, at the top of Homerton High Street, we have one of the great architectural and historical gems of Hackney, Sutton House. It really is an amazing old building, isn't it? It was built in 1535 by Henry VIII's Secretary of State. It's where the negotiations between the governments of Elizabeth I and Scotland took place. Historic events have happened in that house. Over the years, various owners like city merchants and seamen, people like that, they've added their own bits on to the exterior, but at its core it's still a Tudor building, and it's the oldest residential building in the London Borough of Hackney, which of course does ask the question, which is the oldest building in the London Borough of Hackney, if that one was built in 1535. My guess is there's a church somewhere that's older than that, but it's a good trivia question that we'll answer in the comments, I guess. I think this building was derelict for many years, until it was taken over by the National Trust and restored. And now it's usually open to the public. I've been to some lovely events in there, and they do talks and readings and all sorts of things in there. Saw the brilliant Ian Sinclair do a fantastic night in there, actually. So we're going to walk along this beautiful terrace here, Sutton Place, and into St John's Churchyard. This is a beautiful walk here, through to Mare Street and the main drag of Hackney. The remnants of the old churchyard here at Hackney. don't think this monument here is as old as the carvings suggest. I think it's harking back to the medieval period, but I could be completely wrong, of course. Ghosts of Hackney past. Hackney Central. We're just going to be blowing through Hackney, really, so obviously I'm going to miss out a lot of Hackney Central, but we've got to go and have a look at the Hackney Empire, right? COVID testing centre here in the car park, the supermarket. Mare Street. It is Frank Matcham's majestic Edwardian Music Hall, built in 1901. All the greats have performed there over the years. Charlie Chaplin, Stan Laurel, W.C. Fields, Julie Andrews. It really is an absolutely magnificent building. You wouldn't think it possible, but the Hackney Empire is constantly under threat of closure. It's constantly fighting for survival. I can't remember exactly how many Save Hackney Empire campaigns that there have been over the years, but it seems a continuous cycle. I hope it's now finally safe in perpetuity, because it really is a real gem, a real majestic theatre. There's a pub down that alleyway there. I think it's called The Ship, isn't it? Yep. It is the old ship. So we're going to go up Graham Road here to Dalston Junction. I always thought Graham Mansions here were a very fine block of mansion flats. Walking up Graham Road here now really reminds me of that period when I lived in Hackney in the early 90s, and I was unemployed for about 6 months, 5 or 6 months. I went everywhere on foot, and it just seemed to take an age to get out of Hackney. And if you didn't have much money, it felt like you were kind of trapped within it. And it was an amazing place, and it is an amazing place. There was so much to do here, but after a while it sort of became sort of slightly oppressive, because getting away from it seemed impossible. Yeah, beautiful modernist building here at the bottom of Ridley Road. Ridley Road Market, Dalston, another great institution of the area. And another thing which is under threat, constantly fighting for survival. Ridley Road really is at the heart of this community. It would be catastrophic if it were to close. Oh, I've never noticed that before. The Wilton Method School for Cake Decorating here at the end of Ridley Road. Dalston Kingsland station there.
Exactly.
And we're going to cross Kingsland Road, the old Roman ermine street. Walk sections of that out in Hertfordshire, and crossed it on my recent walk up to Stoke Newington in the summer. And there's the Rio Cinema, yet another institution. And yet another institution under threat. Such a fantastic cinema, the Rio. It's what cinema should be. The great old repertory cinema. Used to do a wall chart that you'd have on your kitchen wall. Used to go there all the time when I lived in Hackney, and actually when I lived in Highbury. And then one of the great moments of my filmmaking career was when I premiered my London Overground film with Ian Sinclair there in the East End Film Festival, 2016. That was an amazing moment.
And I was saying to people, really, there's that experience when you walk when you walk streets, particularly if you walk them continuously, you annotate them in a way with memory, with association. But you kind of leave it there. And I walk those same streets between the top of the Penton Mountain and the South Bank every day for about 4.5 years. And whenever I walk there now, it's like I'm being heckled by former memories. I can't walk those streets, I can't actually form any new, because all this stuff is just like bombards me.
Just turned down the side of the Rio into John Campbell Road, heading towards Newington Green and Highbury. Kingsland Road, Dalston, is an amazing centre for food, particularly Turkish food. There's some great cafes down there, and I'm a bit peckish, but of course this is the final bit of the lockdown before we go into another kind of lockdown. But the restaurants and cafes are all still closed, takeaway only, but the Turkish places are shut. Otherwise it would be hard to go along Kingsland Road without stopping for something to eat. We're now going to go along Mildmay Road up to Newington Green, another one of the kind of great historical corners of London. And we've passed out of Hackney into Islington now. Mildmay was the name of the local family who owned this estate back in the Middle Ages. So here we are on Newington Green. Really special place, Newington Green. Newington Green is an old medieval hamlet. It's first recorded as Newton. I suppose it became Newton Green, and Newton became Newington. And then you had Stoke Newington, which is just a little bit further to, I think that's to the north, isn't it? And then you had Highbury, which originally was called Newington Barrows, because that was on the high land, on the hill. And of course, Highbury replaced it. And of course, Highbury is like it's an extension of Barrow, isn't it? And so there's a strong association with burial mounds. And it's believed that Highbury House was built on the site of either a British camp, an Iron Age camp, or a burial mound. But we'll, you know, I've jumped the gun a little bit there, haven't I? So we'll get to Highbury in good time, but probably in the dark. Let's look at some of the quite important and impressive buildings around Newington Green. In the 17th and 18th century and 19th century, Newington Green became a real kind of a hive of radicals and dissenters, particularly religious dissenters. One of them was a bloke called Thomas Rogers, who had a son called Samuel Rogers, who became quite a famous poet. Now, this is a very famous building here, the Unitarian Chapel, built in 1706, associated with Richard Price, who became incredibly influential as a kind of radical thinker and nonconformist in his age. The founding fathers of the United States came to meet Price here, and a whole host of really influential and famous people came to Newington Green to seek the wisdom of Richard Price. We've got green lanes going off down there. It's been suggested that green lanes may have been a drover's road going right the way back to Roman times. So I'm just going to turn off Newington Green into Ferntower Road and head up towards Highbury, up on the high ground. Here we are now at Petherton Road, and I'm pretty sure this strip of green land here is covering the New River, the aqueduct built in 1613 by Thomas Middleton and his company to bring fresh drinking water from Hertfordshire down into London. We've seen the source of the New River on walks up the Lee Valley, up there in Amwell, just near Hartford. It was a real feat of engineering, and we still rely on the New River to provide some of London's drinking water even today, over 400 years later. That's incredible, isn't it? The people who invested in Middleton's scheme, the New River Company, made immense amounts of money and ended up owning lots of central London, because if people couldn't afford to pay them for the drinking water, then they tended to give them like a field somewhere, a field that then later became Marylebone, for example, or somewhere like that. And you see the names of the new River Company members all around this part of London. Thomas Middleton, you've got Middleton Square. There's a big statue of Thomas Middleton on Islington Green. So the source of the new river up at Amwell is celebrated in Amwell Street, which is right near the new river head at the end of the new river. It made the building of this aqueduct beneath my feet here really did help shape London. Even the city that we see here today. It's amazing, isn't it? It's just trickling away here. It is above ground, actually, on the other side of Balls Pond Road. And actually, it's above ground a little bit further up that way in Stoke Newington as well. It is a walk I would do one day, the length of the new river. But it could be a summer thing, right? Up Highbury New Park now. This is a really wonderful street. I used to love wandering around here at night time when I lived in the area. Over 20 years ago now. We now go along Highbury Grove. It's this land here that have all been part of the medieval manor of Highbury, or obviously it would have originally been Newington Barrow. That's such an intriguing idea, isn't it? That Highbury comes from a high bury, a bury being a place of burial, a burial mound often. Particularly then when you hear it was called Newington Barrow in the Middle Ages, it clearly indicates there must be some sort of burial mound here. And like I said before, there was possibly a pre-Roman encampment here, an encampment on the high ground. And we're on a big high ridge. Very high ground. Highbury Fields was where people came to seek refuge during the Great Fire of London, and they looked back down at the city on fire. It was also an area famous for its springs. There was a number of pleasure gardens around here. There was a pleasure garden at Canonbury and one up here at Highbury Barn. None of this has anything to do with the football club, Arsenal, who are of course the Woolwich Arsenal from South London, who then found themselves up at Highbury. And there are also strong associations with the Italian community around Highbury. We saw Little Italy the other week when we were down there walking along the River Fleet down in Clerkenwell. Well, once those slums were cleared and people maybe settled in and made a bit of money, some of them moved up here to Highbury. Calabria Road here. Calabria is a place in the south of Italy. I really love these houses here. And these places have always intrigued me. An adjacent Baalbec Road. And here it is, Highbury Fields. Highbury Fields Forever. I really love it here. So when Highbury Place was built, it stood out, built along the ridge of high land in the middle of fields. This terrace of houses built in the middle of grazing land. And on the other side of Highbury Fields, you have Highbury Terrace, which was built in 1789. Such a special place, Highbury Fields. It's a real place of kind of retreat and tranquility amongst all the hustle and the bustle of the city. The old Highbury clock tower. It's a real landmark in the area. So Lee Road here follows the line of the old medieval moat. It goes down here and then curves round to the right. And the moated manor house sat upon the site, what was perhaps an ancient burial mound or even maybe a pre-Roman camp. And here is Highbury Barn, a place very close to my heart, Highbury Barn. There were always great food shops when I lived up in Highbury Barn. La Fromagerie, I think that's how you pronounce it, La Fromagerie. This is a very famous cheese shop. This is the great old Italian deli where we did all our shopping when we lived there. That's the Highbury Barn pub over there, which must be on the site of the old pleasure garden, which itself was on the site of the farm that fed the ancient manor, dating back at least to the Middle Ages. And this became the site of a very famous pleasure garden. Originally, it was famous for its milks. People come here and drink the milk and eat the custards. But then they had all sorts of things. They had balloon rides here. They had their own orchestra. They used to have operas here. All sorts of grand displays. There was a big public dinner here once with 500 Freemasons. So I think up here at Highbury Barn, a place very close to my heart, is a great place for this odyssey to end. What a great walk it's been. Not the longest, but it's packed, full of interest, full of important, significant, resonant locations. I love it up here. It's so wonderful to come back. Well, thank you for joining me on this walk. Take care of yourselves. As I always like to say, I look forward to seeing you on the next walk, wherever that may be. It could be anywhere. I didn't actually intend to come to Highbury until like yesterday, so certainly looking forward to next Sunday. I really have no idea where I'll be. See you then. Take care of yourselves. Stay safe.